By the age of 26, Napoleon Bonaparte had risen from the obscurity of his Corsican origins to the status of a national hero. He had military genius, coupled with an almost Machiavellian flair for manipulating people and events. In just 16 years, he had risen from military cadet to general of France. Wealthy and charismatic, he was potentially the most powerful force in the land. The boy general would soon find himself in northern Italy, facing an old enemy, Emperor Francis of Austria.
As far as Francis was concerned, French policy in the early years of the revolutionaries threatened not just Habsburg interests of the Austrian ruling dynasty, but also the German princes to the west of the empire, and he was determined to protect them. It's also worth pointing out, though I don't think this was a top factor for Francis, that Marie Antoinette was a member of the Habsburg family.
The central axiom of revolutionary foreign policy was hostility to Austria, and that was personalised in a kind of visceral hatred of Marie Antoinette, which helps to explain why they cut her head off in October 1793. So Napoleon inherits that from the revolution, this instinctive loathing of the Austrians. The French had mobilised an enormous number of men, almost certainly the largest army that Europe had seen, certainly since the Roman Empire. The French had forced the Spanish and the Prussians out of the war, but they'd been unable to deal with either the British or with the Austrians.
The Austrians had moved into northern Italy and were threatening to move against France. It was very clear that the powers of Europe were not happy with the French Revolution, and they were not really going to be happy until the Bourbon had been put back onto the throne. So Napoleon still had opportunities for achieving military glory. All he had to do was get himself off to Italy.
His mind, though, was not wholly preoccupied with war. He had fallen in love with a 32-year-old widowed mother of two, Marie Josephine Rose de Beauhamais, a former mistress of his old friend, Paul Barras. To a woman whose physical charms were already waning, the young hero of the Republic must have seemed the perfect catch. And on 9th March 1796, they were married. 2 days after the ceremony, following a wedding night interrupted by Josephine's dog, Fortuné, Napoleon left Paris for Italy. The newly married general was about to embark on the next phase of his glittering career. The campaign in Italy was a twofold affair. In part, it was an attempt to export the ideals of the French Revolution to other parts of Europe. Perhaps, more importantly, it was seen as a means of swelling the depleted coffers of the French government. A war in Italy would give French troops the chance to live off the land on foreign soil and saving France the expense of funding their provisions. At the same time, there would be plenty of scope for plundering. The campaign also had a non-military purpose, to distract the attentions of the French people from food shortages and government mismanagement at home.
In the period prior to Napoleon's first Italian campaign, France was still having serious troubles. He'd saved the government from one royalist uprising, but the fact is there was still a lot of people who were unhappy with the Directory. The Directory was seen as corrupt. It was seen as ineffective, inefficient. The taxation system, in fact, the whole economic system, was still not under control.
The government had repealed the law of the maximum. This law stated that there was only a certain price that could be charged by dealers for commodities such as bread or flour, meat, etc. When they removed the maximum, of course, the good old human instinct of me first, everybody else last, came to the fore, and prices shot up.
the strains of war and of war finance and of people being taken away to fight exacerbated what was already a situation of great political instability. It was very important for France's generals to win battles. The more that they won battles, it would not only, as it were, create prestige for the regime, but also a sense that it was successful and that therefore it was unwise to oppose it. So that foreign victory was important for internal stability.
Equally, there was a good reason for the French civilian regime in Paris to keep the armies outside France, maintained at other people's expense, at the expense of the Belgians, of the Dutch, of the Germans, and of the Italians. Because if they came home hungry, looking for jobs, looking for homes fit for heroes, then the regime might well find themselves with a problem on their hands they couldn't handle.
Napoleon inherited 37,000 badly equipped and demoralized troops. He gained their trust and respect by presenting himself to them as a soldier.
I am a soldier because that is the special faculty I was born with. That is my life, my habit. I have commanded wherever I have been. I commanded when 23 years old at the siege of Toulon. I commanded in Paris. I carried the soldiers of the army of Italy with me as soon as I appeared among them. I was born that way.
The army of Italy was very much one which Napoleon pushed forward. I mean, he had inherited a force which had been slightly bedraggled, to put it mildly, short of supplies from the previous campaigns, and also not the key force that was supported at that stage by the revolutionary government. They put much more resources into campaigning north of the Alps. So in many senses, Napoleon reformulated his army and drove it forward. He planned the strategy, he planned the tactics. In his early days, he, in a sense, was his own staff.
Unlike his British counterparts, Napoleon could identify with his troops and went out of his way to make them aware of the fact. He knew how to win the hearts and minds of those under his command. Rhetoric, with the promise of reward, was a good place to start.
You are hungry and ill-fed. The government owes you much. It can give you nothing. Your patience, your courage are admirable, but they procure you no glory. No fame shines upon you. I want to lead you into the most fertile plains in the world. Rich provinces, great cities will lie in your power. You will find there honor, glory, and riches.
This was just what the demoralized army of Italy needed to hear. To help him in the Italian campaign, Napoleon gathered around him hugely talented senior officers. One of the benefits of the revolution in France had been the democratization of the professions. Men of merit, whatever their origins, could rise to the top.
1796, after 4 years of wild and bloody conflict on all of France's borders, the commanders in the French army at all levels had elbowed, fought, and dared their way up through the ranks to the positions that they now occupied. They may have had the morals of organ grinders and the manners of their monkeys, and they frequently did, but they were a military meritocracy. They were the right men at the right time. It was a star-studded cast, and we can go to any one of 30 or 40 examples, and you can see what sort of potential these guys had.
The campaign in Italy in 1796 shows what a commander of genius can do to sway a campaign, to change the course of a war. Because according to the grand strategy of the Directory, the army of Italy that Napoleon commanded in 1796 was something of a sideshow. The two main thrusts were coming north of the Alps from the Rhône-et-Moselle and the Sambre-et-Meuse. But it's Napoleon, through his relentless energy, his seizure of the opportunity, his skill, and again it has to be said, his luck, turns what was intended to be a backwater into the major theatre.
Napoleon swept through northern Italy in what was probably the most masterful campaign of his career. The Austrians and their Sardinian allies were beaten in a series of early victories, in which Napoleon made repeated use of a tactic which would serve him well in the future. He concentrated his forces for a decisive blow against the enemy's center. By the end of April 1796, the Sardinians had had enough and made peace with the armistice of Cherasco. The Battle of Lodi, fought the following month, proved somewhat indecisive.
Napoleon comes to the River Adda at Lodi and finds this long, narrow bridge with an Austrian force at the other end of it. To cut a long story short, the bridge is successfully stormed. And it has to be said that the French soldiers involved, including senior commanders, showed very great heroism, gallantry, above and beyond the call of duty in driving the Austrians out.
I think at the time, Lodi was not perceived as being any great victory or battle in its own right. Indeed, it wasn't a great victory. It failed to achieve the objective, which was to destroy the Austrian army. The Austrian army managed to get away. What Lodi represented was the furthest advance in the first stage of the 1796 campaign.
If you look at Lodi strictly from a military point of view, it was a relatively minor action. It was, after all, an action across a bridge against an Austrian rear guard. It was successful, but it didn't have a huge military impact. But the impact it had on Napoleon was tremendous for a variety of reasons. It was at Lodi where Napoleon himself went down and set the cannon into position, a job normally done by a corporal, and so his soldiers began to call him the little corporal. It was at Lodi that Napoleon gave some fiery speeches and personally directed the advance across the bridge. And he wrote later on that it was only at Lodi that he began to see himself as being capable of achieving great things.
After it was over and they'd broken the Austrian position on the far bank and captured most of the artillery, in the aftermath of that action, Napoleon felt that if he could do that, he could do anything.
Lodi is an important part in the painting of the Napoleonic legend by Napoleon. It was when he, in his own mind, thought that he was something other than just a mere general.
Lodi also did wonders for the confidence of his troops. After a string of victories, the army of Italy began to believe that they were commanded by a general who was invincible.
Napoleon personifies the charisma of the charismatic hero. It wasn't just the self-confidence which he possessed himself, which led him to order engagements like the attack on the bridge at Lodi. It was the confidence which he could inspire in others, that what he was asking, which to a normal human being would seem impossible, was possible because he commanded it and he was involved in it. He had the ability to inspire his subordinate commanders and indeed the rank and file to feats which they would not have been capable of under any other commander. And so Wellington says, what was it, Napoleon was worth 40,000 men on the field of battle? And I think he was. The bridge at Lodi is a brilliant example of that capacity of a truly charismatic leader to enable ordinary people to achieve extraordinary exploits.
Within weeks, the Austrians had been driven from Lombardy, and part of the French army settled down to begin a lengthy siege of the city of Mantua. For Napoleon, the way to Milan was now open.
The tricolor flies over Milan, Pavia, Como, and all the towns of Lombardy.
A bitter personal blow soon followed. The directors of the Republic wrote to Napoleon. From now on, he would have to share command of the army of Italy with General François Kellermann. Napoleon was deeply aggrieved.
To give Kellermann and myself joint command in Italy would mean ruining everything. I can't agree to serve with a man who believes himself to be the best general in Europe. And in any case, I'm sure that one bad general is better than two good ones. War, like government, is a question of tact.
Fearing Napoleon might resign, the directors relented.
Napoleon actively propagated an image of himself through friends back in Paris through the print media, which had developed enormously under the revolutionary era, as the great general, the successful general, a great hero. And there was an emphasis on a mixture of skill and heroism and a determined attempt to win, as it were, the propaganda war that was very important. Now, in this, Napoleon was not alone. It's fair to say that by the late 1790s, pretty well all the generals, of the leading generals of the revolutionary armies, were in some respects political generals. They had to be. They had to be linked to factions in Paris, not least in order to ensure their continued position and in order to ensure a measure of support, supplies, a measure of reinforcements. All of them were trying to propagate a favourable impression. Napoleon, though, was particularly good at this. And to a certain extent, this enabled him to push what became eventually a personal foreign policy.
He was the first military commander, I believe, to create his own newspaper, the Courier of Italy. And that was distributed, of course, widely among the army, and indeed was sent back to prime public opinion back in France. We're now talking about 1796. He's acting as a political general already. He's very careful that his men should see the progress of the campaign and place it in a wider strategical context in the way in which he wanted them to.
There was, of course, in Italy, as there had been in many of the German states, a fairly widely spread benevolent attitude towards republicanism. In northern Italy, this was a similar position. And when Napoleon initially arrived and took over, the Italians greeted him with open arms. They were fairly weary of the Austrian yoke, as some of them saw it, and were ready for change. Change they got, because in Napoleon's knapsack was an order from the government saying, strip the place bare and send it back to France.
His armies were unleashed on their cities in an orgy of plundering. Food, drink and clothing were seized to satisfy the troops' immediate needs. They also seized gold and other valuables. Booty to the value of 40 million francs found its way back to Paris.
For the great majority, the overwhelming majority of the Italian people, the French army came in 1796 not as liberators, but as conquerors, and above all, as exploiters in one way or another. There were various forms of exploitation. There was official exploitation, as it were, organized by the army commissars in the form of requisitions and looting and the conscription of forced labor. And then there was, as it were, freelance, unofficial exploitation on the part of the common soldiers and indeed their officers in the form simply of pillaging and looting and rape and murder and all the other horrors of war. This was an army which arrived with nothing, and yet it erupted into one of the richest parts of Europe.
In a very short time, there were many outbursts of civil unrest against the French occupation. This was put down by force. Once again, we have our friend of the revolutionary governments coming forward with the sword to flatten opposition.
There were obviously some people who threw in their lot with the revolution. There were indeed some radicals for whom revolutionary France was the power that they looked to. But it's fair to say that among the bulk of the populace, the French at that stage were bitterly unpopular.
For the first time in years, the army could be properly paid. The little corporal's standing in the eyes of his men rose still further. There were no lengths to which their loyalty would not stretch. But Napoleon had made many enemies. The government knew their commander in Italy was not a man to be crossed lightly, as he had shown over the business with General Kellerman. Pleased though they were with the tide of booty that flooded back to Paris, they could not have ignored the future threat posed by a popular and successful general with a loyal, well-paid army at his back.
The government recognized that suddenly there was a legion out there that was more devoted to its commander than it was to the government, because the government had never paid them, but Napoleon paid them. The government didn't let them get away with murder as he did. They were his.
Because he's so successful, because he's so popular, he's also potentially dangerous. And in that government's lack of stability, any strong force could challenge that government for power. And there was a great concern that Napoleon might well do that.
As the campaign developed, Napoleon began to show very alarming signs of political independence. Napoleon begins to act more and more not as a general, but as his own foreign minister, as his own Chancellor of the Exchequer, as it were, a government on the move, as a peripatetic government. And so he negotiates with the Pope, with the King of Naples, and so on and so forth, with various Italian principalities, without referring back to Paris for permission to do so.
Soon, the Austrians, under General Wurmser, began a counter-attack. Their main objective was to relieve the besieged garrison at Mantua. But in battle after battle, Wurmser proved a poor match for the little corporal and a French army brimming with confidence. On 15 September, Wurmser, with the French at his heels, broke through the ranks of the besiegers and entered Mantua. At first, it seemed a saviour had arrived.
The net effect was that Wurmser and his 14,000 men, including a fair amount of cavalry, unable to defeat the blockading force, were forced into the fortress, thus doubling the garrison. Therefore, the rations and supplies, which had been calculated to last, shall we say, 6 months quite adequately, would now last only three.
For months, Wurmser and 20,000 Austrians holed up in Mantua, living on horse flesh. In January 1797, 28,000 Austrians under General Alvinzi and 17,000 men commanded by General Provera set out to relieve the city. Napoleon had only 20,000 men to pit against them. Forewarned of their approach, Napoleon sent 10,000 men under Barthélemy Joubert to Rivoli, a plateau on which he could range his artillery against the advancing enemy. At dawn, on 14th of January, Napoleon attacked the guns and cavalry under the command of General Kwasdanovich. The move almost failed, as Kwasdanovich turned Napoleon's left flank. Only the timely arrival of Massena after a 20-mile all-night march reversed events. Together, Napoleon and Massena broke Kwasdanovich's corps and another, whilst General Ray took care of a third corps under General Lusignan. The Austrians retreated, leaving 8,000 dead, wounded, or captured. Marching a day and a half non-stop, Napoleon and Massena advanced on Mantua. Provera's 17,000 troops were routed and most were taken prisoner. Alvinzi also suffered heavy losses. On 2nd February, Wurmser surrendered Mantua and its garrison of 18,000.
What differentiated Napoleon's approach to warfare in Italy in 1796 from that of his subordinate commanders, those who had previously commanded the army of Italy, and most important of all, his enemies, was the speed with which he thought and the speed with which he made his men move and act, and the aggression which he built into the culture of the army of Italy, driving them on, making them move faster, think faster than his enemies. I think it was almost an instinctive skill to see what's happening, to feed into an equation all the various problems and to see where the weak link was and where to press at it. And Napoleon showed again and again during that campaign in 1796 in Italy that he was thinking 10 times faster than his enemies.
Northern Italy, though stripped bare by its liberators, was finally free. Napoleon now proceeded to establish a series of new Italian republics. He had no actual brief to do this, but could argue that he was fulfilling his orders by exporting the ideals of the French Revolution.
He set up two republics, the Cisalpine and Cisbadine. He wrote largely on his own the constitutions of these two states, and he appointed all the officials. He was beginning to get to like playing with the clay of the world and forming into his own images.
If you go to the Museum of the Risorgimento in Milan, you will see several rooms dedicated to Napoleon as the first of those forces who led to the unification of Italy. He put the government of Northern Italy into Italian hands. And so I would say his image among Italians and his legacy among Italians is really quite positive.
Napoleon's military adventures in Italy had been wildly successful. He had enriched the nation, won the loyalty of his troops, and lived in Milan like the emperor he would one day become. In December 1797, Napoleon returned to Paris in triumph. Although he had brought glory and wealth to France, his return was unsettling for a weak government that had every reason to worry about the presence of a hugely popular and ambitious general with time on his hands. The Directory decided he needed a project to occupy his great gifts, but distract him from any political ambitions. The project they chose was the invasion of England, and Napoleon was given the role of planner-in-chief.
Napoleon saw Britain as the key power that had built up opposition to France in the 1790s. Britain, after all, had subsidized France's opponents on the continent. Britain was the leading commercial and maritime and oceanic power in the world, the power best placed through its control over international trade to finance opposition. And the British government, under William Pitt the Younger, was a determined opponent.
The constancy of the British government this time has to be applauded. They were iron hard. Napoleon recognized that until he could get across the channel, that little spit of water, and land an army large enough to conquer the place, there was going to be no peace.
The war, in many ways, was doing the British a great deal of good. It had allowed them to mop up Dutch and French colonies in the West Indies, at the Cape of Good Hope, in the Indian Ocean, India itself. The British ruled the seas in a way which they had never done before, so why should they hurry to come to terms? So ultimately, if the French were to secure the gains they'd made between 1792 and 1796, they would have to come to terms with the British.
If peace could not be achieved by negotiation, then perhaps there has to be some kind of military action. And the most obvious military action, of course, would be to invade across the English Channel.
His plan, conceived with the aid of the Irish rebel leader Wolfe Tone, involved a fleet of 65 purpose-built gunboats and 250 fishing boats, which together would carry 24,750 men.
In 1797-98, however, the prospect of a French invasion of Britain was dramatically lessened by a series of British naval victories. In 1797, British squadrons defeated both the Dutch and the Spanish fleets at Camperdown and Cape St. Vincent, and the French had been relying in part on their Allied naval strength in order to cover any invasion. Quite clearly, any invasion of Britain which could not guarantee control over the sea would be astonishingly vulnerable.
He very quickly realised, as he saw the Royal Navy three-deckers cruising up and down the channel, that his gunboats and his fishing boats were going to be blown out of the water as soon as he set foot on the water, so to speak. And after studying the problem for some time and realizing that he could not, with the French fleet in its existing state, achieve supremacy on the channel for more than about 2 seconds, he advised the government against it.
However hard we try, we will not achieve naval supremacy in a few years. To undertake an invasion of England without being masters of the sea would be the boldest and most dangerous operation ever carried out.
With the invasion of England ruled out for the foreseeable future, it was left to Charles Talleyrand, the new foreign minister, to propose an alternative. His suggestion appealed greatly to Napoleon: the conquest of Egypt.
The British control of Egypt gave them the opportunity to get to India and their trade routes and so on, and gave them greater control of the Mediterranean. If the French could take Malta, which was a very strategically located island in the Mediterranean, and throw the British out of Egypt, then it would be possible to pretty much end England's ability to control the Mediterranean and do great damage to her economically as well.
You could point out that pre-revolutionary French governments had been interested in Egypt. Or one could go for a more cynical and Machiavellian interpretation and argue that essentially Napoleon wished to keep control of his army, that the easiest way to keep control of his army was to take it somewhere and engage in operations that might also build up his own personal reputation. I think both of those are true, but I think there is a third factor which, in a sense, is almost more important, and that is Napoleon's absorption with himself.
It has been called his Oriental complex. Some have seen it as the desire to emulate his idol, Alexander the Great.
I'm sure that he was aware of the parallels that would be brought to bear if he were to go to Egypt and be successful against the British. Not only would he strike a blow against the British where he could, that is to say on land, but as he said to one or two of his associates, just think, then there's India, where Alexander had been. So certainly the parallel was there.
Napoleon was always keen to use historical parallels. He had a taste for using high-flown rhetoric about what he was doing. And certainly he liked to talk about great conquerors of the past, Alexander and Tamburlaine and so on and so forth. Whether that really influenced what he did in 1798, I very much doubt.
Egypt was also a very fascinating and mysterious country to the Western world in those days. We didn't have Egyptology like we do today. You didn't have tourists routinely going and seeing the pyramids of Giza and so on. In fact, when Napoleon took his soldiers, he also brought with him a small army of scientists and engineers and artists.
Their primary purpose was to study and record Egypt's wealth of historical and cultural data. Naturally, their work would reflect well on the little corporal who had brought them there. At 3 a.m. on the night of 30th of June, with 55,000 men in squally weather at Marabout, 8 miles from Alexandria, Napoleon reviewed his troops and marched on Egypt's second city. The French were in luck. One of the gates of the city had been left open. By lunchtime, Napoleon had taken the city with only 200 of his men wounded. Leaving Alexandria in the capable hands of Jean-Baptiste Kléber, Napoleon turned south and began the long and terrible march to Cairo.
I saw soldiers dying in the sand from lack of water and food. The intense heat had forced them to abandon their booty, and many others, tired of suffering, simply blew their brains out.
The French hadn't really thought through what the Egyptian invasion would entail. The French had not sent a land force to North Africa since the Crusades. Napoleon was well aware that in terms of firepower, his army was likely to beat any force that the Mamluk rulers of Egypt could deploy against it. But in terms of infrastructure, he was dependent on the resources that he could gain there.
So the march to Cairo was a disaster. They had extreme heat and not nearly enough drinkable water. Men went crazy. Men died of thirst. Men committed suicide. It was not a pretty sight. And when they finally did get to the Nile, many of them drank far too much water too quickly and also got sick.
After 2 weeks, they found themselves in the shadow of the great pyramids at Giza, facing a combined army of Turks and Egyptians 24,000 strong. Napoleon drew up two divisions of infantry in hollow squares, six deep, with guns at the angles. He kept a third division in reserve. Before the battle, he sought to inspire his men.
Soldiers, from the height of those pyramids, 40 centuries look down on you.
The elite of the Turkish-Egyptian army were 8,000 Mamluks, men whose whole lives and wealth were dedicated to fighting. Their leader was Murad Bey, a man who could behead an ox with a single blow of his scimitar. At his signal, the Mamelukes charged the French squares. As they reached them, Napoleon swept in from the rear with the reserve division, cutting the Mamelukes off from their main army. He then ordered his artillery to open fire. The 16,000 Egyptians, who had never seen heavy guns, panicked and fled.
We see here a discrepancy of military technology and organization. And although the enemy fought with conspicuous gallantry and indeed tenacity, the French had little difficulty in dealing with them.
The Battle of the Pyramids lasted just 2 hours, but secured Lower Egypt for the French with the loss of only 200 men. Napoleon marched triumphantly on to Cairo. Bad news awaited him. A British fleet under Horatio Nelson had surprised the French in the Bay of Aboukir. 13 out of 17 French warships had been destroyed.
It was one of the most decisive, annihilating battles in all of naval history. A wonderful example of all the qualities that Napoleon showed on land were displayed by Nelson in a maritime capacity, in command at sea. Daring, enterprise, energy, wonderfully motivated subordinates, and it led to a catastrophic defeat on the part of the French. And as a result, from that time on, Napoleon was trapped in Egypt.
The campaign ground on, but by March 1799, Egypt was under Napoleon's control. The Egyptians named their new leader Sultan el-Kabir. Napoleon now turned towards Syria. Intelligence had reached him that the Turks were planning to mount a twofold attack, via sea from Rhodes, aided by the British, and on land via Palestine and Sinai. Napoleon's plan was to meet and promptly defeat the land army in Syria. Then he would deal with the seaborne threat.
The invasion of Palestine, and then after that the French forces actually moved on into Syria, but the invasion of Palestine was characterised by a number of episodes which can leave you with very different impressions of Napoleon. There was the massacre of over 1,000 Turkish prisoners in Gaza, which suggests a different degree of cruelty and hostility towards particularly non-Europeans, of which there are other signs in Napoleonic rule. I mean, his treatment of the black West Indians of Haiti in an attempt to reconquer those was a good example of his fundamental ambivalence about non-Europeans.
He could do pretty well anything, and no one would find out about it. Or if they found out about it, they'd find out through a carefully edited version which he was providing. And it was in the interests of him, and indeed all around him, to put the best possible gloss on what we would regard as today as completely unacceptable atrocities. I don't think anyone will ever know the truth, the whole truth, of what actually happened at Gaza. The best account, I think, suggests that it was, in a way, an act of compassion on their part to slaughter the prisoners, in that there were no supplies, there was no water for them. They would have died anyway. That's one possible way of looking at it. I think the fact is that so many layers of myth and counter-myth have been piled onto it that we shall never know what really happened.
There's also the very famous visit to sick and wounded people in Jaffa, and which was, you know, much painted. And that presented an image of Napoleon as almost a kind of sort of Christ-like redeemer figure. And, you know, it was designed to complement the idea of him being a great warrior.
And this, I think, quite rightly, as it has been pointed out, this is a miracle-working gesture. He's presenting himself as someone who is so special that he can heal wounds. It's a healing gesture as well as a compassionate gesture.
The French army enjoyed rapid, if hard-won, success in Syria before reaching the city of Acre. The garrison there was defended by the Turks with 250 guns and 800 English sailors under Sidney Smith. Napoleon decided to try and capture it. He had only 12 guns. Ammunition was so scarce, he had to scavenge for spent enemy cannonballs to use. Three times the French breached the castle walls. Three times, they were driven back. Nine more guns arrived by sea, but still the French could not get a foothold in Acre. On 7th of May, 30 Anglo-Turkish ships arrived with reinforcements. Napoleon cursed his men, calling them effeminate, but it was no use. He reluctantly abandoned the siege and returned to Egypt.
The image of Napoleon is that this was a total failure. And certainly there was a failure at the Siege of Acre. But the reality is he stopped the invasion. He prevented the Turks from moving further south and on into Egypt. And he at least temporarily solidified his position, which allowed him to return to Egypt in time to defeat the second Turkish invasion, which came by sea.
On 25th of July, Napoleon, with 8,000 men, met a Turkish force of 9,000 at Apukir. His first offensive drove the Turks back to Mount Vizier. Murat received a bullet from a pistol in his lower jaw, but fought on bravely. After the battle, he could even turn it into a joke.
Tell all the young ladies that even if Murat has lost some of his good looks, they won't find that he has lost any of his bravery in the war of love.
Napoleon's victory was decisive. 5,000 Turks were drowned, some 2,000 were killed on the battlefield, and 2,000 were captured.
No amount of success on land was going to compensate for the fact that he was now isolated. Egypt had not proved a staging point on the way to India, never would have been. There was no French fleet in the Red Sea, there was no particular way in which the grand plans that he entertained, in, at least in his imagination, could have been furthered. Equally, he was now vulnerable and he was distant from the centre of political development in Paris.
So it was time to go. There was nothing left for him in Egypt. On the other hand, back in France, with the war resuming at the end of 1798 and going very badly indeed for the revolution, for the Republican government in the early months of 1799, there was clearly work for him to do there. And that's why he went back.
Once safely back on French soil, Napoleon received the hero's welcome that was becoming almost customary. Many already saw Napoleon as a potential leader of France. But even with popular and military support, he could not risk overplaying his hand. The weakness at the center of French politics had created a complex web of factions, each with its own agenda. These did not necessarily include Napoleon. But events were moving in his favor. Emmanuel, Joseph, Sierre, the man who had betrayed Robespierre, was now the most influential member of the Directory. With another member, Roger Ducos, he planned a coup. But he needed someone with military nous and muscle to complete the triumvirate.
It has been argued, could be argued, perhaps should be argued, that it was only a matter of time before a general arrived to restore order in France. So when Bonaparte comes back from Egypt in 1799, as still with the aura of success around his head, somewhat tarnished by the disasters in Egypt, he's the man to go for.
After all, he was already noted for his willingness to use force, famously with the remark about the whiff of grape shot and the use of cannon on the Paris streets in 1795 to support the government. And although that did not prove necessary in 1799, he was the crucial muscle.
The overthrow of the Directory was planned for November 1799, the month of Brumaire in the new calendar. But the coup did not pass off as smoothly as the plotters had envisaged. In the chamber of the Council of 500, voices were raised against them. Napoleon himself addressed them and was physically assaulted. He escaped only with the aid of his loyal troops, who purged the chamber of dissenting voices. Those who were left formally approved the replacement of the Directory by the new regime. Three consuls, Sierre, Ducos, and Napoleon, would now govern France. Sierre saw Napoleon as very much the junior partner. Not surprisingly, Napoleon saw himself differently.
Napoleon cooperated completely in the overthrow, became the leading member of the government, elbowed the two others aside, cast them into the dustbin of history, and emerged as the First Consul with pretty absolute powers.
Napoleon became First Consul on 25th December 1799. He was now de facto ruler of France.
He's able to secure his authority so easily because he's not associated in people's minds with any particular political grouping. He's only associated with military victory. And so he could be all things to all people. And so to the left, he could do things which made him appeal to them. He could do things to the right, like concluding a concordat with the Pope, which would lead to reconciliation with the Catholic Church and all those millions who still supported it in France. He could appeal to pretty well everybody and put it together in a package so that they could all say, well, perhaps we're not getting everything we want, but we're getting enough. Including, of course, most importantly, military victory, sealed by the greatest, the invincible Napoleon Bonaparte, to make them continue supporting him.
Within months, the renewed Austrian threat in Italy saw him back on the battlefield. With a force of 24,000 and greatly outnumbered, he faced the Austrians at Marengo. Once again, the gods smiled on him. What could have been a humiliating defeat was turned into a resounding victory. But the Austrian threat was not about to go away. The stage would soon be set for one of the crowning achievements of an already illustrious career.